Thanks for joining me. Happy Friday. I'm Carla with Race to Walk, and this is my friend Riz Crescini. He's actually, we're here at Houston Baptist University this week, and Riz is actually in the apologetics program, but he lives in Japan, and he's coming and visiting just here for the week, so he's doing this Bible study with me, so I thought that was kind of cool.
Yeah.
So, and this is the first time we've met in person. We've talked online in our apologetics group, but we've never actually met in person today. So today what we're going to be covering in our our weekly Bible study is the topic is actually when you ask God for direction, make sure that you are actually going to do what he says. So it's a serious thing that when you are praying to and communicating with God that we have to be ready to do what he says rather than continue to go our own way. So anyway, but a little bit about this Bible study. If you haven't watched before, I do a weekly Bible study Mondays or Fridays at noon Central, and we've been going through the one-year chronological Bible. So if you want more information about that study or how to follow along, I do have a post on my blog at racetowalk.org. You can just go do a search for one-year chronological Bible, and it gives all the details. And I also have notes for this study that I'm going to be sending out, so you can sign up for updates by going to racetowalk.org/notes, and then when you sign up for updates, I'll be sending them out next week. So a little bit of an overview. We have been in the prophets, and I don't know about you, but I've read through the Bible. I've read the major and minor prophets, but this study has really, it's really kind of helped put the pieces together for me, because you can see how much and how far God went to warn the Jewish people to go speak to them and tell them to repent, to turn around, that there was going to be a time when judgment was coming, and that he warned them over and over and over again before they were finally taken into captivity. And in this portion that we're in right now, Jerusalem was actually destroyed, and the first temple was razed. So that was Solomon's temple, and that was destroyed. It wasn't rebuilt until Ezra came back and they started rebuilding the temple. So anyway, just to recap, in 609 BC, so we have already been through the divided kingdom, where Israel is a northern kingdom, the larger kingdom that had been taken into captivity before Judah. Judah is a smaller kingdom that's left there. And they had kind of put their trust in Egypt. And so in 609 BC, Pharaoh Necho takes the king of Judah, Jehoahaz, into captivity in Egypt. Then in 605 BC, so Egypt at that time was a major power, and then but then Babylon is rising up, and actually I think it was Amos that actually prophesied that rising, and he came and Nebuchadnezzar took the royal family and some of the nobility into exile in Babylon, into captivity in Babylon, and that was the exile that Daniel was a part of. And I do have a study on that on Daniel chapter 1. We go over that. Then in 598, Nebuchadnezzar, there's still some, there's still kind of some stirring up, rebelling against Nebuchadnezzar. So in 598, Nebuchadnezzar comes back, lowers a boom. He said, takes everyone pretty much except for the poor into captivity in Babylon. And that Ezekiel is part of that group. So it's a seven-year period. Daniel has come to prominence. Ezekiel goes in, and we covered that. I think it was last week in Ezekiel 14. Then 5 years later, Ezekiel receives his first vision. And this is kind of significant to what we're going to be talking about today. So he sees this wild, crazy vision. He sees the throne room of God is himself, with the seraphim around him, with the wheels, with the eyes, and it had this wild vision. So he was kind of known for somebody who had a line with God, but we're going to see if it benefited the Jews in exile or not, because they actually weren't listening to what God had told them. So in 588, just another 5 years after that, there's another rebellion against Nebuchadnezzar. So all this time, from 609 to 588, God is telling the Jewish people, you need to repent, you need to repent, you need to confess your sins, you need to repent. They're still doing the same thing. The last couple of Bible studies I have, we see that they were very hypocritical. They said they followed God, but they weren't. And so they just kept doing what they're doing. They were there for a show, but they didn't actually listen to and follow God. So at that time, that's when Jerusalem falls, that's when the temple is razed, and there's basically next to nothing left, as far as identity of the Jews as a nation. And there is, but the things that they really identified with weren't there anymore. So then in 583, so Nebuchadnezzar had appointed somebody to oversee this little remnant of Judah. But in 583, there's all this intrigue. This is part of the reading for this week, if you've been reading along in the one you're in the chronological Bible. There was some intrigue, and Gedaliah, who was the ruler, was assassinated. So this is covered in all the drama behind it. Is 2 Kings 25:22-26, Jeremiah 47-12, Jeremiah 40:13-18, and Jeremiah 41:1-18. So if you were reading along, there was quite a bit of discussion about it in these two books. And I never really recognized that until I read it through in this chronological series. So because of that, the Jews were afraid that Nebuchadnezzar was going to come and retaliate against them. And so they wanted to go to Egypt. But before they did, they came to Jeremiah and they said, okay, well, we're going to, and Riz is going to read this. So there's one.
Jeremiah 42?
Yeah, 42:1-22.
1-22.
Yeah.
Then all the army officers, including Johanan, son of Kareah, and Jezaniah, son of Hoshaiah, and all the people from the least to the greatest, approached Jeremiah the prophet and said to him, please hear our petition and pray to the Lord your God for this entire remnant. For as you now see, though we were once many, now only a few are left. Pray that the Lord your God will tell us where we should go and what we should do. I have heard you, replied Jeremiah the prophet. I will certainly pray to the Lord your God as you have requested. I will tell you everything the Lord says and will keep nothing back from you. Then they said to Jeremiah, may the Lord be a true and faithful witness against us if we do not act in accordance with everything the Lord your God sends you to tell us. Whether it is favorable or unfavorable, we will obey the Lord our God, to whom we are sending you, so that it will go well with us, for we will obey the Lord our God. 10 days later, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. So he called together Johanan, son of Kareah, and all the army officers who were with him, and all the people from the least to the greatest. He said to them, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, to whom you sent me to present your petition, says. If you stay in this land, I will build you up and not tear you down. I will plant you and not uproot you, for I have relented concerning the disaster I have inflicted on you. Do not be afraid of the king of Babylon, whom you now fear. Do not be afraid of him, declares the Lord, for I am with you and will save you and deliver you from his hands. I will show you compassion so that he will have compassion on you and restore you to your land. However, if you say, we will not stay in this land, and so disobey the Lord your God, and if you say, no, we will go and live in Egypt, where we will not see war or hear the trumpet or be hungry for bread. Then hear the word of the Lord, you remnant of Judah. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. If you are determined to go to Egypt and you do go to settle there, then the sword you fear will overtake you there, and the famine you dread will follow you into Egypt, and there you will die. Indeed, all who are determined to go to Egypt to settle there will die by the sword, famine, and plague. Not one of them will survive or escape the disaster I will bring on them. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. As my anger and wrath have been poured out on those who lived in Jerusalem, so will my wrath be poured out on you when you go to Egypt. You will be a curse and an object of horror, a curse and an object of reproach. You will never see this place again. Remnant of Judah, the Lord has told you, do not go to Egypt. Be sure of this. I warn you today that you made a fatal mistake when you sent me to the Lord your God and said, pray to the Lord our God for us. Tell us everything he says and we will do it. I have told you today, but you still have not obeyed the Lord your God in all he sent me to tell you. So now be sure of this. You will die by the sword, famine, and plague in the place where you want to go to settle.
So, this is, I mean, what would that be like? So you have Jeremiah, who, when he first started, launched into his career as a prophet, he was young, and God had told him, you know, don't let anybody dismiss what you're saying. You're going to say what I tell you to say, and that he would perform the words that he told to Jeremiah. There were a lot of, up until, like at this point, there weren't a whole lot of people left, but in most of Jeremiah's career, there were the priests and the actual authorities in the temple. There were a lot of other prophets that were saying, you know what, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. You're going to be coming home soon. And God told Jeremiah, it's not going to happen. They're lying. You know, they're saying peace when there is no peace. It's not going to be short. Settle down, you know, settle in. You're going to be there for a while. So don't listen to these others. So all of this is going on. So try to imagine yourself in this situation. And you're the leader here, Johanan, he had actually warned the Babylonian ruler that, you know, there was this plot against him, and the Gedaliah ignored him, and he was assassinated. So he's probably, you know, he's probably thinking, just think about how much turmoil and anxiety it is. And so, but they go to Jeremiah. They go to Jeremiah and they say, okay, well, we'll do whatever God tells us to do. But was that true? So Jeremiah tells them in the beginning, like, I know you weren't going to be listening to me. I knew it from the beginning. You're not going to. You're going to do what you want to do. So here's the thing. There's a couple things. You know, there's a verse that says the Lord disciplines those who he loves, right? And, you know, God does love all of us. He wants what's best for us, but he's not going to let us continue. We need to come into, you know, obey his will. We can't continue to do if we continue to do what's wrong, then eventually he's going to allow the consequences of those actions to come on us. And if you read nothing else, read this last week in the one-year chronological Bible so you can see how many times God warned that. I mean, this whole time in the prophets, it has been a warning, and they ignored it. And so I think that for us as Christians, you know, what we read in the Old Testament, it shows us the nature and the character of God. And so if God disciplined the nation of Israel and the nation of Judah, the Jewish people who are his chosen people, who he has said are to be assigned to the nations, then do we think that he's not going to discipline us if we're doing the same sorts of things? So last week in the study, it was basically on some reasons why God doesn't listen to your prayer, right? And it was mainly unrepented sin. So sometimes, and I said this last week, and I do want to say this again, sometimes you can be in a season where you don't feel like you're getting an answer. That doesn't always necessarily mean that, you know, there's unconfessed sin somewhere, but it can. It can mean that you just, it's a time where you need to draw closer to God and really press in and, you know, really seek his face. And so sometimes that's what it is. Sometimes we just have to wait, but we can't be complacent about the waiting. We still have to be constantly, you know, seeking God, asking the Holy Spirit, you know, the prayer of David in Psalm 51:10-12. I think if you are lost about how to start really asking God to, you know, convict your heart of anything that isn't pleasing to him, this is the one to go to. Is it says, create me a clean heart, O God, renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. So even in the willingness, sometimes we need the help of the Holy Spirit to do that. He has to clean out the, you know, when we make Jesus the Lord of our life, we have the Holy Spirit dwelling within us. And then he can start cleaning out these things. He can start healing us from, you know, the trauma of the past. He can start healing our emotions and bringing them more in alignment with him. If we have reactions to things and triggers, you know, he can start that process. It's not an overnight thing. It's every day, step by step. You know, we should be growing closer and closer to the image of Christ, right? It's when we make Jesus the Lord of our life, that's the beginning of our journey. We don't stop and sit at the door. You know, we continue on, you know, drawing closer to God. So, but the thing is, and I've seen this with, I've just seen this, especially sometimes it's actually the people who are most seeking after God's voice that can get maybe a little off. Sorry, the air conditioning's coming on right now. But sometimes when we ask God for direction, it's not what we think it's going to be. So they probably thought the logical choice is going to Egypt. They thought that was a safer route. But God told them, no, stay here. Nebuchadnezzar will not come after you. I will bless you. I will prosper you here. But they didn't trust him. And then they did what they thought. And then in, this is in 44, what happens is, if you go and read a little bit further, he says, God tells them, they go into Egypt and they start worshiping the Egyptian gods. They start making sacrifices to the Queen of Heaven. And they actually respond to Jeremiah saying, hey, look, you know, we were an offering to the Queen of Heaven, and look at all this that came upon us. So we're going to go to Egypt and we're offering to her, because they were putting their trust in these other gods for safety and deliverance, rather than looking at what all these prophets for decades have been telling them. The issue is, you need to repent. And they wouldn't do it. I'm like, no, this is a problem. We need to do this to fix it. So anyway, so then what happens is that Egypt actually is invaded and conquered because of the Jews that disobeyed God and went into Egypt. So this is in the very first Bible study I did. It's like sometimes our associations can get us in trouble. I mean, was it Paul that says it's a serious thing to fall into the hands of a living God?
Not sure about it.
Okay, right. Yeah, I think it's Paul, but I mean, it's the New Testament. Paul wrote most of the letters, so I have the chance of being right. But anyway, so if you're going and asking God for directions, guess what? You know, the key is that we have to listen to his voice. We have to seek his will in every single area of our life. So, you know, our decisions about our job, our decisions about our family, you know, all our decisions, we're supposed to be seeking God for direction. But when you do, make sure that you're willing to actually follow them. So, for example, the rich young man who came to Jesus and said, what must I do to be saved? He said, give up all your possessions and follow me. And he wasn't willing to do it. So don't actually ask if you're not willing to do it. Because if you're not, you're going to bring a judgment on yourself that would have been worse than the issue that you would have gotten into even without direction. So,
Hebrews 10:31.
Not Paul. It's Hebrews.
Author of Hebrews.
Yes, author of Hebrews. So, like I said last week, the first step to drawing closer to God is we need to ask the Holy Spirit to cleanse our heart. And so, and this is, I've mentioned this before, I think that sometimes in Protestant circles we kind of get a little, not careless, but we don't always place as much emphasis on prayer like we say in the words, and you know, we believe God is there and that he hears us, but we don't always, you know, sit and think, okay, well, what is my part in this? How do I need to approach God? Where, as in the Catholic tradition, you know, some of the Desert Fathers, they had a whole process that they would, I can't remember, who was it? One of them, that they would pray, is it Ignatius? They pray every day, And they would pray three times a day. So in the morning, they would pray and ask God to, you know, fill them and cleanse them. And then they would pray at noon and they would reflect on the past few hours and ask the Holy Spirit, like, you know, were my actions, my thoughts pleasing to you? You know, and then they would do that in the evening. So it was a day-long process where they're going back and reflecting and trying to bring, you know, so that they can, we're supposed to be a clean vessel, right? And Jesus said that when your life is, when you have no dark corners in your life, that your light will shine brightly. And so we have to let the Holy Spirit cleanse us. So if the Holy Spirit convicts you of something, it may be an attitude, it may be maybe words, it may be a habit, just repent of it and confess it. And then plead the blood of Jesus over that in your life and ask the Holy Spirit to enable you to have victory in that area. Because I think that some people, you know, think that when you're a Christian, you're done, and we're not. And so sometimes, you know, sometimes it takes a little longer for the Holy Spirit to work in us. It depends on how willing we are to submit to Him, right? So last week I mentioned that I had mentioned that there's a time of Teshuvah, which is a time known as a time of repentance. It's the 40 days before the Day of Atonement. It was the time when Moses went on Mount Sinai to get the second set of tablets. And it's a time of, I mentioned this, I have a blog post on RaceWalk.org. It says, thankful for the fast yeses. Like in this time, this may sound a little bit, you know, out there, but I have seen like very fast answers to prayer. But part of it is because it's a time of repentance. So we confess our sins, and He's faithful, just, and just to forgive us our sins. And so we can seek Him and ask Him. So one of the things that I had mentioned last week is to ask God, you know, for a prayer assignment. And I actually got one that I wasn't expecting. But for this next 40 days, it actually starts on the Jewish day starts the evening, the night before. So it's the evening of the 31st, Saturday, and begins Saturday to Sunday. Just ask God to give you who He wants you to be praying for, and make those next 40 days a really, just set aside that time to really seek after God and to always be conscious. I mean, think about it as if it's like a detox, you know, so where you're watching what you say, watching what you do, and just journal it every day and see what a difference is. So write down, you know, your thoughts or what you're praying about or how you feel about your relationship with God. And then just every day, you know, just be consistent about praying and praying for that, not only for your prayer requests, but for that assignment that God gave you. And then see what the end of the 40 days is. Because it's really, when you look at it that way, it's really amazing how God does work in our life with prayers. He does answer, but sometimes we don't realize it if we're not making a note of it and marking it down. So I've kind of rambled on. Riz, did you want to ask any, or mention anything?
No, that was great.
Okay. So, we are, I guess the main takeaway from this, and it's been like this for the past few weeks, is that the main key is obedience. And like we tell our 8-year-olds in our third grade Sunday school class, delayed obedience is disobedience. So when God tells you to do something, do it fast.
Right away.
Decide in advance you're gonna do it, and just do it. Don't even think about it. Just do what God says. So I think that's enough for this week. Riz and I are gonna go have lunch. And I hope you have a great weekend and a great next week. And I just pray that that you can hear God clearly, that you know that He's there with you, that you feel His presence with you all through this next week, and that you know when He's directing you in something, and that you're willing to respond to that. So I will see you again next week. Talk to you soon.